sorry, technology can sometimes become a disaster, embarrassment. This morning I would like to start a series on Christian leadership. This will be my first of many sermons that are going to come along the way. This morning I would like to focus on what is Christian leadership.
Hello.
What is its uniqueness? What Christian leadership is all about and its uniqueness. God willing, in a couple of months' time, we shall have our new board, new leadership formulated. It's my deep concern and prayer as a pastor of this church that the new leadership will be the best or one of the best in God's side. It is with this burden, concern that I would like to bring this sermon to you. I hope and pray that this will be a blessing to all of you as you pay attention to the preaching of God's word. I hope and pray that the church would be ready herself to have a church board that will please God, honor God. Even as we prepare ourselves, we should see God's intervention and His blessing on the new leadership. I trust that this sermon will be a blessing to each one of us, especially those who are aspiring to be a leader. You know, almost everyone is called to lead in some capacity. A father spiritually leads the home. Parents lead the children. A teacher leads the class. An employer leads employees. A pastor leads a church. The senior leads the junior. Everyone leads someone. In whatever leadership God has placed us with, we must try to model Christ-like leadership. That's the key that I would like to emphasize again and again this morning. Our leadership must be modeled after Christ-like leadership. This is an enormous problem in the world today. If you see around, there is a huge leadership crisis all across the globe. The world is obsessed with the idea of power, position and leadership. When you talk of leadership, the first thing that comes into mind is power. How much power am I going to have? What position am I going to occupy? How much benefit am I going to get? Now, these are the things that are going to strike our mind the moment we come and think about leadership. This is seen not only in political world. We see this happening in the corporation. We see this happening in business. We see even to some extent in Christian organizations. And sadly enough, inside the churches. The crisis in the church, the crisis of leadership, the study of it is very important. I tell you why. The leadership, today's leadership is confused with a certain personality type. We all have come up with some kind of idea that our leader should be like this, like that. We have begun to stereotype our own leadership. And that's the problem the church faces today, the organization faces today. Leadership, the temptation to implement their secular principles rather than implementing biblical principles. Leadership becomes, for some people, a means of obtaining power, position, prestige in the church, in the society. And it has gone furthermore. There is carnality, worldliness, selfishness seen in lives of the leaders. I'm presenting you the fact. My friends, we as church, leadership is indispensable. Leadership is utterly important because it has a phenomenal potential for growth and success. The success and the growth of the church depends on what kind of leadership we have in the church, in the organizations and elsewhere. Without proper leadership, the church is unable to fulfill the mission God has given to the church. And today, the lack of leadership has become plague in many of the churches. Churches have paralyzed. They are unable to grow. They are unable to make impact in the society. They are unable to expand their ministry. They are unable to make impact in the lives of the people at personal level. And that's why I would like to dwell on this topic, Christian leadership. Some of the leadership wizards, experts, they have come up with almost 850 definitions of Christian leadership. I'm not going to take you through all those 850 definitions, but I would like to present to you just three definitions, those caught my attention, arrested my attention. Here I present. The first one is by Harold Guinin. He says, leadership is the ability to inspire other people to work together as a team under your direction in order to attain a common objective. That's what Harold Guinin thinks. And the second one is by George Barna, very famous person. He says, a Christian leader is someone who is called by God to lead, leads with and through Christ-like character, and demonstrates the function and competency that permit effective leadership to take place. This is a good one. Then the best one, I think, is this: leadership as the exercise of one's spiritual gifts under the call of God to serve a certain group of people in achieving the goal God has given them towards the end of glorifying Christ. So from the reading of these three definitions of Christian leadership, you might have understood that Christian leadership is not in our hand. It all begins with God. Because a leader must be called by God to lead a group of people with Christ-like character towards fulfilling the very purpose of God. That's what Christian leadership is all about. Let's ponder on three biblical truths on Christian leadership this morning I would like to present to you. You know, the text this morning that we have read is not exactly what I'm going to focus on. The text is about leadership, yes, but I would like to just deviate from that. Only take that concept of leadership from the text and try to help you understand what Christian leadership is all about. Because, you know, in one way or other, we are all in the leadership. You're all in the ministry of God. You're all serving God in different capacity, whether it is a church or mission, organizations, anywhere that God has given us the opportunity to lead someone in our lives, we exercise leadership quality. Now this morning, I would like to present before you three important truths. I want to press on three important truths regarding Christian leadership. The first one is, leadership is a calling, not an occupation. Leadership is a calling, not an occupation. What do you mean by that? It's a call from God. It is an appointment from God. It is an ordination from God. It all comes from God. It is God who first thinks about you, that you should take up the responsibility for His glory, for His honor, that you should be in a place where you should be able to lead people to grow, to mature in Christian faith. It is an appointment by God. Call is a lifetime appointment in which you devote yourself to the ministry to which God has called you. It's not a social work. It is not a job. It is not a profession. My friends, leadership is a call from God. It's a call from God. It's a divine appointment. It's a divine ordination. I am reminded of a joke that was very famously told whenever calling is being discussed. And this joke goes like that. A young farmer standing in the field observes the unique cloud formation. Please listen very carefully, otherwise you will miss it. A young farmer in the field observes a unique cloud formation, and there, this is what he finds. The cloud forms three letters, G, P and C. As he looks up the cloud formation in the sky in a unique way, he observes three letters. The cloud looks like G, the cloud looks like P, and the cloud looks like C. So he interprets this G, C, P and C as, go preach Christ. That's his interpretation. So immediately he ran to the deacons of the church and he says, "Deacon, God has called me to preach Christ." He goes and he bothers the deacons of the church saying that God has called me to preach Christ and give me the opportunity to share the word of God from the pulpit. So what the deacons did, you know, they succumbed to his request and they say, "Well, since you are so affirmative, so strong, so dogmatic that you have been called by God, okay, we will give you an opportunity." So he was filled the pulpit, you know, he was invited to fill the pulpit, and one Sunday he preached a sermon. It was long, boring, tedious, incoherent. There was no unity in what he was preaching, and the board of deacons, the deacons were stunned silence. They didn't know what to say. And one of the deacons was very wise, and he was correct in his observation, and he reached up to him and said, he says to this young man, "Preacher, it seems to me the cloud says it is not go preach Christ, it is go plant corn." It is not go preach Christ, but it is go plant corn. Sometime this is what happens with us in recognizing the call of God. We misunderstand the call of God in our lives. In the Bible, whether in the Old Testament or New Testament, you see God calling people. It is not people trying to fall on God and say, "Lord, I want to serve you, I want to serve you." No, it's always God calling people. God calling people. We can see that happening with Abraham. We see that happening with Moses. We see that happening with Jeremiah. We see that happening with Isaiah, all the prophets. And when you come to New Testament, Jesus calling the 12 apostles, and the Holy Spirit calling Paul and Saul, Paul, Barnabas, always from God. Call to leadership is always from God according to the scripture. How do you differentiate between calling and profession, my friend, this morning? Some of you may be confused. How do I know the call of God? Yes, I aspire to be one of them. Yes, I aspire to be leading people. But you got to be sure that it has to be the call of God, the calling of God. Here is how I have differentiated between calling and profession. Calling. In calling, the source is always God. In profession, the source is always human being. Calling requires 24/7, your all times, whereas profession requires 8 hours or more. Calling, it makes you accountable to God directly. Profession, you are accountable to your employer. Calling, you are not salaried, you are not on payroll. In profession, you are on a payroll, you are a salaried person. Calling, it gives you pleasure to serve God. The love of God compels you to serve Him. Whereas profession, you feel your profession burden. I have heard many people say, "I don't want to continue anymore, I better resign." A lot of people take VRS. Why? It becomes burden to them. Whereas in the ministry, there is no, you know, it doesn't become burden to you. With all your infirmities, you still say, "I find pleasure, I find joy in serving Christ through the leadership that God has given me." In calling, it is spiritual duty. In profession, it is secular duty. In call, there is a passion that with which you do, whether it is preaching, teaching, or leading people, counseling people. Whereas in profession, it is not a passion. You just do it so that you get paid. Calling is a dedicated service. Calling is a dedicated service, whereas the profession may not be a dedicated service. Calling requires sacrifice. Calling requires sacrifice, whereas profession does not require sacrifice. If you wish to sacrifice, you may sacrifice, but sacrifice may not be the requirement for you. Calling has no retirement time, whereas profession has a retirement time. My friends, these are the things that will help you sense the call of God, whether or not you should take up leadership. Friends, Christian leadership is a call of God. It is not a profession. A lot of people, they take it very lightly. They think that, well, I have been appointed for 3 years, 4 years, whatever number of years. Let me somehow do it. No. It is a call of God. God has ordained you. God has appointed you. And you must serve Him to the best of your ability. You must give Him the best time that you can. You must give Him the best you can. That's what God requires from us. That's what God requires from the leaders in the church. It can happen only when you take it as a call of God. As a call of God. Now there are three important components of the call of God. First one is a desire created in your heart. How do you know that it is a call of God for me? Well, God will give you a desire in your heart. He will give you the desire. Nothing wrong to have a desire to be a leader for the cause of Christ, if it is sincere. The Lord will put a desire in your heart. Second, the Lord will give you opportunity. Not only He will place desire in your heart, if He has called you, He will place a desire in your heart. If He has called you, He will give you opportunity to serve Him. And if He has called you, He will confirm through God's people. He will confirm on you, God's people, that you are the right person, that you are the ordained person to be serving in the church. The most important thing for us to learn is that leadership is a calling. Don't miss it. Make no mistake about it. The second thing, the second principle is that leadership is God-given ability for service, not natural ability. Leadership is God-given ability for service, not natural ability. A lot of people think, well, I am born leader. I have the leadership instinct in me, and therefore God has to use me. Not necessarily. Not necessarily. That is not how it works. That is not how it worked, at least in the biblical times. Friends, there are two types of spiritual gifts that God gives to the church. First is administration. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 28. Second is leading. The spiritual ministry. The shepherding. Administration and shepherding. These are the two leadership that God has given in the church. So in the sovereignty of God, what God does, some persons are gifted with leadership. No doubt about that. And some people are endowed with leadership. Some are born leaders. So to say, they have the leadership instinct with them. And some are called by God and they are equipped by God. And that's what we see in the Bible. When the Lord calls us to leadership, He gives us a skill to do it. Let's not misunderstand. When we serve God, we don't serve Him with our natural abilities. We always serve Him with special abilities given to us by God. Because He expects from us, you know, the unnatural things, supernatural things. Unimaginable things can be accomplished through our lives. And that's what God has done in the past, in the biblical times. You know, spiritual gifts must be aligned with our calling. So the practice, the training will enhance our skill, and same time the Lord will give us the opportunity to slowly develop our natural ability into spiritual ability with the power of God. With the power of the Holy Spirit, you'll be able to excel in the ministry that God has placed in our lives. You go through the pages of the Bible, you will see God has appointed people who felt themselves unworthy. Look at, if you consider Gideon, for example. Gideon, what did he say? He said, Lord, how can I save the people of Israel? I cannot be the one, because the tribe which I represent is the weakest tribe. I don't think I have any chance. I stand no chance. There is no possibility that I will be able to save Israel. But the same Gideon was empowered, energized by God to deliver the children of Israel. David. Why David? David king, the king David, before he became king, before the Lord enthroned him as king, he was nowhere in the picture. He was nowhere in the picture. But in the mind of God, he was there. And God equipped him. He was just a shepherd boy. You look at Jeremiah. He was a young guy. just 20 years old when God called him. He said, Lord, I don't know what to speak. I don't have any words. I do not know how to preach. I do not know how to articulate. How can I stand before elderly people? The Lord says, well, I will put my words in your mouth. I will sanctify. Isaiah, Lord, I am undone. I am sinful. How can you use me? The Lord said, I will sanctify you. He touched his mouth, sanctified him. You see in the Bible, God used people who considered themselves weak, sick, who considered themselves unimportant. God strengthened them. Similarly, Apostle Paul, he was a blasphemer. He was a persecutor of the church of God. No one would ever thought that he was going to be a great missionary, that he was going to be a great preacher to the Gentile world. But God did it. God chose him, used him, molded him. At the end of his life, he was able to pen 13 letters. We find in the New Testament. My friends, leadership is God's ability for service. It is not natural abilities. God always gives us special strength, special grace, so that we may be able to serve a special God, that we may be able to do a special thing here for His cause, for His kingdom. When Saint Francis was asked regarding his call, he said, God picks the weakest, the smallest, the meanest of men on the face of the earth, and He uses them. That's true. He does that. We should never rule out anybody to be in the service of the Lord. Friends, in the Bible we see when God called people, He always used them with their weakness. He gave them the strength that they needed to be able to achieve what God wanted them to achieve. If you look at Noah, he was able to build a gigantic ark, humanly not possible, but with the power of God, he was able to do it. Moses, leading 2.5 million people, almost 25 lakhs of people, leading them, one man. Not possible humanly, but he did it. It's all because God empowered him. Elijah, man who was afraid to stand before the king, he stood before the wicked king and he was able to prophesy. Apostle Paul stood in front of the Gentiles, the leaders, and he was able to preach. Yes, special ability granted. Never ever discount yourself. Well, I don't have the ability. Well, I'm not able to do it. Well, I don't have the desire. My friends, God gives you it. God gives you the strength. God gives you the ability. He is with you. He will be with you. He will energize you. He will teach you what you ought to do. That's what He does. When God called Moses, He said, Lord, not me. Not me. You take Aaron. Not me. There was no second Moses. There was no second Moses. Only one Moses. Moses was far too less talented than Miriam and Aaron. These people were outspoken. They were able to articulate. They were able to lead people, organize people. They had all natural abilities with them. But God did not choose them. God chose Moses and He enabled him. He was stammering, but God enabled him, touched his tongue, sanctified him, and made him a great orator, a great leader. My friend, leadership is a special ability for service. Third thing is, leadership is all about serving, not being served. How often we think, when you take up leadership, you think you have become a boss. It's not about bossing people around, at least inside the church, at least in the service of the Lord. We are not bosses. In the ministry, in the churches, when God calls us, we are all servants. We are all servants of the Lord. If you go a little further, we are born servants. We don't have the will of our own. We completely surrender at the feet of the Master, our Lord Jesus Christ. Leadership is all about serving. It is not being served. It is not bossing people around. Jesus Christ, He set a beautiful pattern, beautiful leadership model. and that is called servant leadership. Nowhere else you will find in the world. No organization, no firm you will find this servant leadership. Jesus is the one who set the trend for us, my friends. He says, I came, for the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister. Mark chapter 10, verse 45. And to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus set a new pattern of leadership for us. So that we don't expect people to serve us. Rather, we look for opportunity to serve others. Whether you are a leader or you are not a leader, remember, the principle is the same. The Lord has called us to serve others, not to be served. Jesus reminded his disciples in Luke chapter 22, verse 27. He says, who is greater, he that sits at table or he that serves? Is not that sits at the table, but I am among you as he that serves. Jesus himself was a living example to the disciple. He said, who is greater, the one who is sitting at the table or the one who is serving the table? He says, the one who is serving the table. Jesus, do this. And Jesus, even he went further. If you look at John chapter 13, verse 12-15, our Lord Jesus Christ, he introduced and modeled the concept, the servant leadership concept. And he was a model servant leader. And he expected all his disciples to do the same. Look at what he has done. In John chapter 13, verses 12-15, he dramatically portrayed what it meant by serving people. Let's read that. So after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments, was set down again, he said unto them, know you not that I have done to you? Know ye that I have done to you? You call me Master and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash another's feet. I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Look at what Jesus did. He washed the feet of Jesus and he said, this is what I want you to do. Don't take it literally. If you want to do it, you can do. But it is all about attitude. Are you willing to be served or are you willing to serve? Jesus has called us to serve others. How much are you willing to serve? How much are you willing to sacrifice your time, your money for the cause of Christ? Look at the humility in which Christ has expressed through this washing of the feet of the disciples. My friends, interestingly, there are two words used in the Bible. They also convey the same idea. Two of the words used to describe leadership is minister. The Latin word minister comes from the Latin word meaning servant, and deacon from the Greek word means the same, servant. And this is one of the most favorite words in the New Testament for church leaders. Servant attitude. Willing to serve others. Not expecting people to serve you. That's what leadership was all about. Serving others. Just as Christ served us, so also we must be willing to serve. And he says, the role of a Christian leader is to be a servant of servants. Servant of servants. Can you be a servant of servant? Or do you want to be like the secular leaders who try to impose their ideas, who try to impose their ideologies, the way of life? Or you are someone who follows the principle that Christ has taught us? My friend, Christian leadership is a calling. It is not a profession. It's not a profession. Let's not take that way. It's a calling. We are accountable to God. And we must be available for the Lord's service. And we must find joy in serving Him. Never ever regret serving Christ. Never ever regret serving Christ. As long as you hold the breath, as long as you have breath in your nostril, keep serving the Lord. Leadership is God-given ability for service. If the Lord calls you, remember, He will equip you. He will enable you. He will be with you. He will touch you, sanctify you. All that is necessary for you to serve Him, He will do it. And make sure that you accomplish His will. The third thing that we saw, biblical truth, is leadership is about serving, not being served. May the Lord help us so that we may be able to become a servant leader. Leader willing to go extra mile. Leader willing to serve others. Serve others without expecting any service, because that's what God has called us to do. Wherever you are, whatever capacity God has placed you, remember, this is what the Lord is expecting from each one of us. Shall we close our eyes? Let's look to the Lord in prayer and commit ourselves. Father, we thank you for your word which has come to us. Lord, we thank you that you have given us the opportunity to be a leader one way or other, outside the church, home, school, wherever you have given us the opportunity to lead people, O Lord, you expect us to be a servant leader. Father, what an opportunity to be called by God. We thank you that the call to service is the highest calling anyone can have. Lord, we thank you that you have made your power available to each one of us, your presence available to each one of us. We thank you that you have set a beautiful example of serving people. Father, we specially commit our church, our present leadership and the would-be leadership. We pray that you would bless us, bless our church, that our leaders will be one of the best, O Lord, and that this church will go from strength to strength, fulfilling the ministry which the Lord has given us. Lord, even as we walk out from this place, we pray humbly that you would continue to minister to us, speak to us. Lord, we commit this week into your mighty hand. Bless the work of our hands. Bless the time at office. Use us for your glory. Keep us from falling. Keep us from sin and temptation. And help us to be in the center of your will, O Lord. Help us to glorify your name. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to us. We ask this prayer in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. And God's people say, Amen and Amen.